it going?
Yeah.
It's filming?
Yeah.
Here we are outside of Benny Carter's house. Sometime this can all be mine. To play a lot of gigs. Hot tamale, huh? What's wrong?
Nothing is...
Is it working, you think?
Yeah.
All right, you can turn it off. Later. We gotta get a video of Mulholland Drive, man.
Here we are, driving up Skyline Drive, up to Benny's house. There we have Mark driving. Hello, Mark.
Hello there.
And here we are at Benny's house. And we're a little early, so we're gonna call and see if it's okay to go in earlier. Maybe we may just wait here a little while.
So wonderful. I could actually play it for you. With you. As a duet. This one.
Who's the piano?
Oscar.
Oh, yeah.
So here you come. Thank you.
Does he know God?
No, I wanted to know.
He had a thing all his own, didn't he?
Yes.
All his own.
Beautiful kind of sound.
Yeah.
Did he come up playing with Woody?
Yeah.
That's where he really kind of got it.
I think so, yeah.
Yeah.
You can hear his, you can hear his heart in this.
Yeah. Oh, he sounds so beautiful. I never knew him, but I can just imagine, you know.
So few people can play with that feeling.
Yeah. You know, this song is so appropriate. Oh yeah, I have so many. You know, Benny, now, this is such an appropriate song because one time you were playing at Carlos. So I came down and I brought my horn because I said, well, you never know what could happen. So I had underneath my chair, and it was a great night and it was so wonderful. So I had to go to work for a few days. I came back on Sunday to see you again and I didn't bring my horn. So I sat down and I was sitting with Jerry Dodger and a few people and you came up, Mark, how you doing? Got your horn? And I didn't. And you know what, you guys went up and played, you and Milt, Laura. And I was thinking, oh! But you know, it just happens. Now I didn't realize Oscar could play so pretty too. He plays a chordal solo. Just beautiful in there too. Show you these things, Benny. You know, a lot of times when you're traveling or going someplace, there's all this idle time. So when I found out I was coming to see you, I started doing a bunch. And I have about 10 or 12 here. I wanted to play some of them for you, too. I was hoping that I could maybe play a couple with the, I would love to, like Frenzy.
I don't even be making that.
Maybe we could do it. Maybe I'll play it. I'll play
yeah,
it with the thing.
Sure,
I would love to.
Got your horn here,
I have my mouthpiece. I didn't know if you had an alto. Maybe I could play it. I can play it right with the thing.
Right.
You're going to like it. So far I've found two of your Lauras. This one to me. And you've only heard just the one opening chorus. This next chorus coming up is... Ooh. This is the part that got me over here. Well, this is Oscar play now, but when you played this is one of the things that I learned so much. It's an F sharp half diminished. You were playing an F major. It was so beautiful, it just killed me.
Well, they're starting it over here now, huh?
Yeah, you'll start about right here.
Oscar,
yeah, Oscar's got one. And now here you are. So beautiful. Ooh. Thank you.
Yeah.
He made that in 1954.
Mm.
I don't remember, but I liked it.
Isn't it beautiful?
I guess so, yeah.
It's probably strange.
I don't know when I've heard it. I just...
See, off that particular record, I took all of these, Benny. I'll tell you what happened. I'm riding a train between New York and Saratoga, and they start like this, with just the scribblings, you know. And then I put them in, like I showed you before, I was putting them in the computer so they look nice and stuff and clean them up a little bit. So I started on this record, and there were so many I liked. There's this Long Ago and Far Away. Or Gone with the Wind. And I did a Long Ago, Far Away, Gone with the Wind. I've got The World on a String. And this Frenesy, which is Frenesy. Totally unbelievable. It's on here. Frenesy's on there. You had asked me before, so I tell you what I'll do is
I don't even remember doing that.
Oh, boy. It's so great. I got to go out for 1 second.
Gee, the whole treasure of them over there.
I got so much.
Yeah.
I think it's 17.
Frenzy. I don't remember playing that. Bobby White. The drummer?
Ray Brown.
Bobby White.
Bobby White, they say.
Who is he?
I don't know. He sounds good. Song, you know.
Hearing, yeah. Jesus, I don't remember that at all. Was that 1956 or something like that?
Yeah, 54.
54, yeah. Okay. Jesus.
Just a moment in time, right, Benny? A moment in time.
Just a moment in time.
And then I got bewitched by my one and only love.
My one and only love.
With Don Abney.
Don
Abney playing the piano?
Oh, he just died about a month ago.
He did.
A few months ago, yeah.
I didn't know much about him, but it says in the records that you liked him and you played with him and a little bit. Playing, made some recordings.
You got some of that too here?
Mm-hmm.
With Don Abney?
Yes.
And you know, he went to Japan and married a Japanese woman and sired a couple of children.
He did.
And then they broke up and he came back home for a visit.
Oh.
And he was supposed to be here just a few days and he died.
Oh.
So I've always said he came home to die, you know. He must have
yeah.
Been sick. I didn't see him or hear from him. But
yeah.
Mm. Yeah, he had good taste.
Did, yes?
Yeah, uh-huh. He was not like a Peterson, but he had a good
yeah.
Taste, you know. That
yeah, it was very, very nice.
Singers used to love him.
Uh-huh.
Singers just loved it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's a whole work in itself, being able to play.
Absolutely.
For some
Absolutely.
One time, I think one of the first time I started discovering that was out on the Norway. I was hanging out with Jerry Dodgen, and he invited me. He said, we're going to go down and play a little bit with Tommy Flanagan. So I had this record that he made with Coleman Hawkins, where it was so beautiful. And I used to transcribe some of the music and play around with it. And Jan knew I loved this record, and she put words to some of Coleman Hawkins's.
Oh, really?
And when we were apart, she sent it to me as some love letters and stuff, you know. And singing with Coleman Hawkins, recorded in the background, with her singing these words. So it was real special tunes to me. So when I saw Tommy, the first time I met him, I said, I studied these songs that you were playing with Coleman Hawkins. He said, well, play one for me. So I started playing the melody, and he didn't remember it, but he just started finding it like water pouring in. And I swear, Benny, you know, I've been around very long, but it didn't seem like he was playing chords. He was playing sound. He was just putting this kind of sound that I needed in the back of a melody. It wasn't like a chord or something.
Yeah.
It was like two people finding each other or something.
Yeah.
And he
conversation.
Just really,
I mean, was beautiful at that.
Yeah, real soft.
Let me hear something by Don Abney.
Okay,
just,
yeah.
Because it's been so long, I've almost forgotten, but not really forgotten. But I mean, I just, and he didn't make a lot of recordings, you know.
Yeah, I didn't know that. Hadn't heard of him. If it wouldn't have been for you, I probably
would.
Season 4-5. This is this one, 3-4-5. You probably saw that one. I think what this is a very interesting record because it's trio, quartet, and quintet. And it's stuff that, for whatever reason, didn't get put out.
All of these with me. With me.
Yes. The first ones are with Teddy Wilson, I think. So you have, I'll give you those. Like, this is something we were listening to, in fact. See if this brings back any memories. I really love Teddy.
Oh, yeah, Teddy. I was going to say that's not done.
No. Isn't Teddy beautiful?
Yeah, Teddy, sure, yeah.
And he caught every little thing. There's some of these recordings he made with Prez, where Prez is just skating through, kind of ignoring all of these sixes and all these little things, and Teddy was like an angel, just playing all of them exactly. So smooth and beautiful. Was he a nice man?
Very.
Teddy? I know you guys knew each other for a very long time, I think, yeah.
Forever.
I think these at one time were hard to find or something.
Teddy?
No, this trio record for some reason, and now they put it out so we can all enjoy it, you know?
I don't know. This cover looks familiar.
Yeah.
But I don't know if I
know how they put it all together. You want to hear some Don Abney?
Yeah.
All right. Let's see. I think it's track 10. This is just my one and only love, and it really bewitched me.
Thank you. It's so beautiful. Isn't that mesmerizing? You look beautiful.
I love this town. I just told you I was back in the past. That's over 50 years ago, so I guess.
Sure.
What's interesting, you know, they came here just a week before my 95th birthday. They sent a crew over here from the BBC.
Oh, okay.
They came over on Friday and they went back on Monday.
Yeah.
And they interviewed me to do four programs on or around my birth date.
Uh-huh.
So the guys, well, hold on, I'm saying this if they work for 1.9.
It was hard to read because it was such a long time ago, or?
No, this was just a couple of months
right.
ago.
Yeah. Oh, good.
Just a month ago, all this.
Yeah.
This October.
Yeah.
Just back in August.
Yeah.
And we like and they brought me an album of some music. I think they're selling my music on there.
Yeah.
That I haven't heard. That I when I was in London with the BBC.
Yeah.
I was writing for the dance orchestra.
Right.
George Henry Hall. I don't know what's on there that of my arrangements because I know they didn't put on arrangement by so and so and so. So I haven't even played it yet. That's been 2 months. I haven't played it yet. But I said that to say what? I was going to say something else.
Not sure, Benny. I'm thinking you were thinking that, like with this, is you did it 50 years ago and there's so much music that you've done that you didn't. You did it at the time, but you haven't heard it since then, maybe, just
I've none of that since then.
Yeah.
That's over 50 years ago.
How does it feel to listen to these things so
well, I don't know. I didn't listen to it.
Right.
I haven't listened to it yet, and I still have it, you know.
Yeah, you probably have it on a pile of things.
Under a pile. On a pile, under a pile.
Sure.
But I haven't even opened it, you know, the CD.
Yeah.
It's on a CD. I'm surprised to know that they'd even done that, you know. All these years.
Well, you know, I thought I had a lot of things. I don't have everything, but the other day I found some stuff called Tickle Toe, which was 6 saxophones. And
11 saxophones.
Or 11.
You found that? Where'd you find it?
The same place I bought this other one. They had that over there, and so I picked that up and started listening to it. So there's so many things that are just dropping off of trees. You know? Tickle Toe, I think it's called Tickle Toe or something. So there's so much.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
From 1964 and something didn't come out very well. From what it was supposed to be. But they wanted to do it, but they wanted me to make it too commercial, you know.
Right.
So it just came out bland.
Right.
You know what I mean?
It's sure. They don't let you go, yeah.
Nothing real interesting, you know.
Yeah. Well, I don't know. I mean, that's in one of my piles now. You said you like transpose score. So this is this honeysuckle with the 4 saxophones. And what we're gonna do is, we can do whatever you want, of course, but I thought what we might do is first listen to it.
Oh, you recorded this? Is it?
No, we're going to listen to your version, but I transcribed it all. All the solos.
Mark, where do you find the time when you still have to work for a living?
You know, Benny, Frank West came to me and he said, I want to study with you.
Sure.
I go, you got to be kidding. He goes, I want to study Organization 101. I don't know. I don't think it's anything. I just... I tell you what, I've always had this dream, many dreams, but one of my dreams was I wanted to ask you about some of these things. And before you've told me, well, this is just kind of close block chords and stuff, but there's some little things in there. Mm-hmm. So I started what I did was I transcribed the arrangement Animal of Souls. So maybe we can listen to it. And then I have a few little places I want to ask you a question or two. But this is, as you know, so much fun. And I also love the fact that each guy gets one chorus. Yeah, it's so great. So what I was wondering about, Benny, was...
You've got one note on here that doesn't look like the notes you played.
Please. Where would this be at?
Oh, you have a... Oh, well, you've got a question mark under it, too.
Yes.
Yeah. Interesting. I didn't see the question right there. I think you did mean it F natural.
Right. I was wondering whether it would be F. You could have it as a... See, here's what I was wondering. I wonder if I could do it like... If I did something like... So would it be?
So you're right. You're right. Yeah, I hadn't even, I hadn't noticed that it was the.
I never put any key signature. I just kind of put the accidentals
in. That's it. That's interesting. Yeah. Oh no. Then.
So I think.
No, you're right. You're right. You even the note I mentioned. It's right if you don't have a key signature.
Right.
Yeah, I just took it for granted that there was a key signature.
Do you think that he, so, does that sound about, let's see. And I was thinking maybe.
Yeah, sure. You got an F natural there, but I was thinking that you had it.
Right. I understand.
I was thinking you had it in F concert.
So you think that probably at that point you're playing F and Phil was E flat,
yeah,
and Hawk was E flat and yeah. So
whatever.
It sounded about right.
Thank you.
right, huh, Benny?
That sounds right to me.
And then the end.
Diminished chord.
Diminished chord?
Yeah, absolutely.
The one question I was also asked you was, at this point, you could play... I think you could also play maybe... because it was a little more smooth.
Yeah,
slight. But see, I have to tell you, Benny, I couldn't make out the fourth voice, but I just guessed. Do you think that that...
It
seems like it sounds okay, but you're never sure because, you know, one line, like I say, I can do one line. Really good. I have to show you these things. I've done so many one-line transcriptions. But when you start, when you get four lines or five lines, and you wonder, like there's one place here where Coleman Hawkins switches. He switches to a slightly different line. It was not exactly what you would think. You see the tenor part? I think that's what he was playing, but it sure sounds about right, but... dreams, Benny, was sometime...
I wish I had your ears.
Oh, no.
I'm not kidding. Are you kidding? Gee.
I was hoping sometime, like, it would, you know, because there's so many beautiful things on there, I would like to start getting into them, you know, and studying them, but I'm only doing it from my one side, which is, for example, I can't hear the fourth line, so I just had to guess and put it in, but I'll give you some other things, Benny, like, I got interested in, here's all these different Charlie Parker solos. So I just transcribed them all.
All of these?
Yeah, they're all in here, all written for the alto. Now,
where do you find the time and the patience?
Well, I want to learn, man. I want to keep learning my whole life, and I just keep. Now, here's another one. These are like what I call great saxophone solos. That a lot of people say, Coleman Hawkins, Body and Soul.
Yeah.
You know the ones I mean. So I did all of those, and I have them all on here. I can sit and play them. I've learned so much. Now, here's this one you think is funny, maybe. Cannonball, he had this song, Work Song. And I found out he recorded it 17 times. Because I have a lot of different records. So the way my mind works, I said, I think I'd like to study and see what he was doing. So I transcribed his work songs. And I put them in a score.
Mm-hmm.
So the first time that he plays the song is across the top. Mm-hmm. And then over the years, his different solos go down. So in 20 minutes or so, I can kind of study and see, here's how Cannonball kind of evolved on this one song over the course of like 17 years or something, you know. So, I just want to keep learning. And this Honeysuckle, though, seems about, maybe about right, but I'm not exactly sure. There could be a few notes, but it basically is, you think it's okay? It's fine.
Right.
It sounds, you know what was amazing to me when I listened to it? The voice, it's so positive and sparkling and optimistic and beautiful and pretty. And when we played it with four sections, and everyone was like, man, that sounds great. My part feels great. It feels right. So I've never really, I don't know. There's so many different ways to voice chords and stuff. I guess that's a whole
lot. Oh, yeah.
This one is pretty basic, right? Like just from the bottom chords.
Absolutely basic. Absolutely basic. How the hell do you do that? I didn't think I had to do it all.
It's a lot of hours. And now this guy's asked me to transcribe these Jerry Mulligan and Bob Brookmeyer things. And I think I would enjoy doing that because as you transcribe, you can learn the tune.
That would cool.
And I remember I learned a lot of tunes from you listening to you play.
Really?
Because you played so clear and beautiful that if you were listening, you could learn how the song goes, somehow. From just hearing you play, you know. Now, I also have this, I played this one for you over the phone. We met this little girl in Denmark. I think we're going to adopt her.
Oh, yes, you told me, yes.
Camila. She's going to come next year. She's 12. Uh-huh. So maybe, if we come over here, I'd like to introduce you to Camila.
Mm-hmm.
But this song came so quickly. I was talking to her on the phone the day that I left, and the night before, her mother asked, she said, if something happens to me, would you and Jan want to take care of Camila? And we've been wanting children, but none have come to us. So we said, well, of course. Because I know enough, I've got a great life. I have so many great things. I don't know if I can really, you can't push or ask for too much. You know what I mean? I mean, there's always, somebody's always looking for something, I think. But anyway, Camila, she's so great. And so this song kind of came real quickly, and it came fast. I don't know if, I'll play a little bit here. I started fooling around with it a little bit, and I found a few, I still haven't finished, but I found a few counter lines up there. Thank you.
that'll work out?
Yes, lovely. Camila.
Camila. Camila. Camila. What are you doing to me? Camila, Camila. Wee-do-wee. She's the cutest little girl.
How old is she?
She's 11. Jan taught her how to play the flute. And we bought her a flute, and we've been calling her once a week, and she's learning English. And I think her mother hopefully will be okay, but I think she just needed to know that maybe someone could be there.
Where is she?
She's in Denmark, in Odense, where Hans Christian Andersen is from.
Did you go to his house?
Yes. There's a little museum over there. Yeah. I started reading some of those Hans Christian Andersen fairy tales, and they seem so idyllic and beautiful, but they also are very violent. There's a lot of this guy chopped this guy's head off. And I guess a lot of things we do with kids have that in it. Like, you know, when the cradle...
Does she speak any English?
Yes, a little bit, yeah.
They're all pretty English.
Yeah.
All of those books. Countries that have just small populations.
Yeah,
you know, they have to learn English or don't leave home.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. Too many places they will go to people that have even heard of their language.
Yeah.
More or less of their country.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. So that's kind of what's been going on. We've been, I still haven't decided whether I want to do this with a quartet or maybe a. Even this guy asked me now about writing some kind of orchestral piece or something. This could work with strings or something.
Well,
something
I do some quartet things of your own.
Yes, I know.
Instead of, you know, transcribing these, put something of your own.
Yeah, of course, I know.
I
should. Oh, of course. Yeah. I feel like I have a lot of energy and I'm still learning.
A lot of creativity.
Yeah.
Sure.
Well, a lot of this last time when I went, we played everything that I wrote. I felt so insignificant because I only have, I think I have 10 or 11 big band. They're all originals, though. And, but we played them all, and they sounded fine to me. But there's so much more to,
you know,
I've only been writing. Yeah, I think I'll continue, and it's a lot of fun, you know. In some kind of ways, I find it actually a little bit easier to play my own music than... playing standards or something for some reason.
Yeah, you're close to it.
Yeah.
You interpret it as you know how it's to be interpreted, you know.
Yeah.
And I think that's the way you should really go from here on in.
Yeah.
You know, it's nice to transcribe these things.
Right.
Practice. That's a
yeah.
I'm amazed at how well you did these things. I could not have done them even when I was when I was doing that for money.
Well, you know, I'm sure you.
And you can do this, and you can do this for your own.
It's probably fun,
so to speak. You know.
Yeah.
And
it's fun to. It's fun to learn. And what I try to tell students is, I don't know if I'm thinking along the right lines. I believe I am. That I think, in order to really play how you want to play, you should be able to play what you hear. And have it. What the notes that you want it to be.
Yeah, and hear inside.
Yes.
Not only what you hear on the record.
Right.
What you hear inside.
Right. So I try to tell students that a CD is just someone's ideas that are frozen in time. One moment. So what's really great about the CD is we can listen to it a lot and fool around with it, play around with it at the piano. Try to bring it out, but you should have the skills to bring it out. Because if you don't have those skills to bring it out, how are you going to bring out what you have yourself?
How are you going to put it down?
That's how I was thinking about it. I didn't really ever do any of this to steal someone's lick. So there's something about the process that's so fascinating to me. There's only 12 notes, but to take these notes and say, oh, this is kind of the line that he made, or this is what he did, and then when I look at him, makes me happy for some reason. I don't know what it is. I think it's
especially all the distraction that there are in life, to keep yourself focused on really great things is wonderful. You know, like I listened to a recording, I'm like, oh wow, listen to what Charlie Rose was.
Yeah, that's really great. You know.
And Coleman Hawkins, that solo he played on, that's pretty wild, isn't it? He came in with that.
The way he burst.
Yeah. I remember you telling me that you were, you said he was a very strong man, Mark. He, we were driving around in France, and he had a bottle on the seat and never missed a turn or anything, just.
That's fantastic. Wow. The first time I ever rode in a car over 100 miles an hour, he was at the wheel. I probably told you that.
No.
Yeah.
Oh, boy.
That was his car, and he wanted to show up and wanted me to try to come take a ride with him. This was like 5 or 6 o'clock in the morning, you know.
Yeah.
Up there on the Holland Speedway above 150th Street.
Wow.
155th Street.
Wow.
Boy.
Yeah.
And he wasn't drunk, but he was drinking all night. He had control.
His name?
Absolute control. He was a good driver.
Yeah. I remember a funny story that there was a young guy hanging out in New York in maybe 1968, 67, and he was complaining to Cannonball Adderley, and he said, Cannonball, Coleman Hawkins makes me nervous. And Cannonball said, Coleman Hawkins is supposed to make you nervous.
That's right. That's right.
Isn't that great?
That's right.
You know, Benny, I also made this, I started making little saxophone caps.
Oh, boy.
You know how you travel and you're always on the...